Hello friends, welcome to one more new video of Learn It, and without wasting more of your time, let's get started. So today we'll be taking topic 6 of chapter 2, which is sexual reproduction in flowering plants. So before moving forward, let us take a small recap of the previous video. We started from the embryogeny, and we have also studied about the two topics, which is the dicot and the monocot embryogeny, and all the development of the embryo we have already studied. So now let us move to a new segment, which is about the formation of seeds and the fruit. So it has many of the different parts. Let us start from the first thing. Now, what is a fruit? Basically, fruit is a ripened ovary or the fertilized ovary, which is called a fruit. Now, what is the wall or the pericarp? Now, walls of the ovary forms two things. It can be fleshy or it can be a dry fruit. And the outer wall will be called as a pericarp. Now, this fresh fruit consists of different layers. So, the outermost covering will be divided into three categories, which is the outermost will be called as an epicarp, middle one will be called as mesocarp, and the last one will be called as an endocarp, which is the innermost layer of the fleshy fruit. It does not apply onto the dry fruits. Now, when we are seeing the lower diagram, which has been in yellowish color, it will divide into seeds and pericarp. Now, seeds consist of three things: endosperm, embryo and seed coat. And pericarp consists of three things, which is the epicarp, mesocarp and endocarp. Epicarp is also known as exocarp. So now let us move to the next topic. It is the covering of fruit that develops from the ovary wall. So different parts of the fruit will be developed from the different coverings of the ovary wall. The first is, it is a part of a fruit and is dry or fleshy. Now, what is covering doing in this topic is, it helps in the protective covering and providing the nutrition to the seeds. Now, ripened ovule inside the plant is known as the seed, or the ripened ovule inside a flower will be known as the seeds. Now, what is the fate of the integuments? Now, the integuments of the ovules forms the coating of the seeds, which is coated around the seeds. The outer integuments forms testa and tegument, which develops from inner integument. We have already studied about the testa and tegument in the previous topic. Now, let us move to the next topic, which is about the fate of different parts of ovary when the development of fruits and seeds are occurring. So there are two parts. The one is floral parts and the second is about the fate after the fertilization has been completed. It has been divided into two categories. A section A consists of sepals, petals and stamens, which is present in the flowers. And it also consists of ovary, but ovary has four more extra things, which is known as ovary wall, ovules, integuments and fertilized egg. So let us start with the first thing, which is about the sepals, petals and stamens. These all thing will just drop off or all wither off, which means they will just drop down. And when we are talking about the ovary will ultimately become a fruit, ovary wall will become fruit wall, ovules will become the seeds of the fruit, integuments will become the coating of the seeds, and it will be divided into testa and tegument. And the last one, which is the fertilized egg, will present inside the seed coat and is called as an embryo. So this is the final fate of different parts of the ovary. So now let us take another segment, which is about the endosperm. And we know that endosperm gives the nutrition to the seeds of the plant. So now, due to this, endosperm is present or endosperm is absent, the seeds are classified on the following basis. It has been divided into two categories. One is known as non-endospermic and the second one will be called as endospermic. Non-endospermic is also known as ex-albuminous and endospermic is also known as albuminous. Now, as the name suggests, non-endospermic means there will be completely using of the endosperm. So let me clarify it. The food stored in endosperm
is completely used up by the developing embryo at the time of development. So these kind of seeds will be known as non-endospermic or ex-albuminous. As in case of broad bean diagram, there is no endosperm present and it has been used up completely at the time of the development of this seed. Now let us talk about the second topic, which is the endospermic or albuminous plant, albuminous seed, sorry. Now this endosperms grows vigorously and is not used up completely by the developing embryo, and some of the endosperm remain inside the seeds. In this case, the cotyledons are thin. For an example, we can take the seeds of wheat, barley, castor, poppy, etc. will contain some amount of endosperm in it. And the diagram has been given of maize, where you can easily see the different parts like endosperm, cotyledons, plumule and radical. Now the next segment is about the important. The first point is about the evolutionary achievement. Because it protects the embryo, it will lead to the evolutionary development of a flower, and which will result into a development of a new seeds or a new kind of a plant. The second one is seeds have enough or sufficient food reserve that can nourish the germinating embryo. So it also helps in the reserving of the food for the embryo. The next is seeds can colonize and populate new areas and spread and propagate its species because of the dispersal, which means the seeds can disperse from one place to another, and the colony of the seeds or the plants can populate the new area so that there is different variety of plants at different levels and at in different areas also. Next is, as the seed are the production or the products of sexual reproduction, seeds contains various variations, and these kind of variation will help in adaptation to various different kind of environments. The last one is, humans can easily germinate and sow these seeds. That's why seeds are very important. Next topic is about seed viability. Now what does it mean? It is a period of time in which the seeds retain the ability to germinate. Now this seed viability is determined by basically two things. One is genetically and second one is environmentally. Now environmental conditions also depend on two things. One is humidity and second one is temperature. So now let us talk about genetically viability. Now some genetically seeds range from few days, one season, 2 to 5 years to approximately 100 years, but there are also records that has been found that seed viability has been found out to be more than 1,000 year old in lotus. 2,000 year old seeds of Phoenix dactifera that were excavated from King Herod's palaces near the Dead Sea have been found to be viable. So the oldest viable seed is 2000 year old, which is Phoenix dactifera. Similarly, 10,000 year old seed of Lupins actis, which is also known as lupine, excavated from Arctic tundra, not only germinated but also produced the plant that also flowered. So when we are talking about the seed viability, it can be old as 10,000 years also. Now this seed viability can be tested by two things. If a seed is viable or not, it depends on the rate of respiration and the germination. If seeds germinate, it will be called as a seed viable, and if it respire. Now for checking this respiration method, if we are keeping it in triphenyl tetrazolium chloride. Now what happens in this is, when we are keeping these seeds near these kind of chemicals, it will turn colorless material into pink color. Now what is colorless? The triphenyl tetrazolium chloride is colorless, and when we are keeping it with the viable seeds which will respire, it will turn this chemical into pink and convert the chemical into triphenyl formazine. Now there are some of the important topics which has to be discussed in this chapter. Let us start with the first topic, which is about the apomixis. Now what does the apomixis means? It has been divided into two categories, which is a Greek language. Apo means without and mixis means marriage, which means apomixis finally means without marriage. So it is a formation of new individual by asexual mode of reproduction or asexual method, which will mimic sexual reproduction, which also will have seed formation but will not involve the fusion of gametes or the sex cells, which includes male and female. The normal type of sexual reproduction have basically two features. One is meiosis and fertilization, which is called as empimixis. The organism reproduced through apomixis is called as apomycetes. Last one is apomixis is controlled by gene and individuals are genetically similar to the parents producing them. So basically all the individuals will be clone and member of clones are called as ramets. They will all be same. It occurs by basically two methods. First is the formation of asexual seeds if the embryo develops directly without the gametic fusion. Apomixis will occur. And second one is known as saprophytic budding. If embryo develops adventitiously from diploid cells of nucleus or integuments, it will be called as a process of apomixis. Let us talk about the second definition, which is known as parthenogenesis. Now what do you mean by parthenogenesis? It has been divided into two types. One is haploid parthenogenesis and second one is diploid parthenogenesis. Let us divide these parthenogenesis into different parts. Now parthenos means virgin and genesis means descent. So virgin descent, what does it mean? It is a development of a new individual from a single gamete without the fusion with another gamete. It is called as parthenogenesis. Now depending upon the types, these are of two types. One is haploid and diploid. What happens in haploid parthenogenesis is the embryo sac is formed and its eggs are haploid, which means it has only one set of chromosome from a single parent. And in diploid parthenogenesis, it also contains embryo sac and contains eggs which is in diploid number, which is in double the quantity of the chromosomes. So these are the kinds of parthenogenesis. Now let us talk about the third definition, which is the apogamy. Now it is the formation of a sporophyte or the embryo directly from the cells of the gametophyte. It occurs in the higher plant. Only diploid apogamy is successful. That is, the gametophytic cells forming the sporophytes is diploid. In lower plant, haploid apogamy is equally successful. Some of the important topics is also called as polyembryony. Now what do you mean by polyembryony? Which means poly means many, embryo means embryo. Now the phenomenon of having more than one embryo is called the polyembryony. It is the occurrence of polyembryony due to the fertilization of more than one egg cell is called simple polyembryony. Now formation of these additional embryos can also occur from different parts of the ovule, such as synergids, antipodals, nucleus, integuments, etc. For example, polyembryony is present in citrus fruit, groundnuts, onions, opuntia and Mangifera indica. Now these polyembryony has been discovered in late 1719 by Leeuwenhoek, and it has also been confirmed by Snarp in 1929. It is more commonly seen in gymnosperm than in angiosperm. Polyembryony can be false or true embryony. In false embryony, multiple embryos arises in different embryo sacs in the ovule, whereas in true embryony, multiple embryo sacs are formed in the same embryo sac. So let us move to the next segment, which is about the parthenocarpy. Now parthenocarpy has been divided into two parts. The first is the parthenos and the second one is carpos. Parthenos means virgin and carpos means fruit. So it is the process of formation without an event of fertilization. Now parthenocarpic fruit will generate seedless fruits. For example, pear, banana, pineapple, etc. Fruits that have seeds with an asexual embryo or pseudo seed are also called as parthenocarpic fruits. Parthenocarpi is of three types, or depends on three types. One is genetic, second is evolutionary, environmental, and the third one is known as chemically induced. Now let us talk about the first topic, which is known as genetic Parthenocarpi. So Parthenocarpi, due to genetic differences or alteration caused by some of the mutations or hybridization, is called natural Parthenocarpi. For example, in banana, apple, pineapple, varieties of grapes and pears, these kind of genetic Parthenocarpi occurs. And when we are talking about the environmental Parthenocarpi, due to the low temperature, frost and fog, which can induce Parthenocarpi in a number of plant, for example, pears, olive, capsicum and tomato, these are some of the examples of genetically Parthenocarpi and the environmental Parthenocarpi.
I hope you might have understood these topics very well. If not, I urge all of you to again repeat the video and watch it again. You can also note this topic down as your notes so that you don't have to refer the books. We at Learn It are working hard to bring you all the easy and simple learning materials which can enhance your learning and listening capabilities. If you are finding hard to understand any of the topic or want to know something in detail, you can comment your questions down below in the comment section. If you like our work, please give it a thumbs up, and if you want to get updated of our new videos, do subscribe and hit the notification bell icon so that you don't miss any updates from the channel. For more of such kind of updates, stay tuned to the channel. Stay healthy, stay safe and fit. Bye bye.